All right, ready? Let's go. Let's do it. Welcome to Sports Back Talk with Bolley and Ringer. And our guest here this week is Seven Simon. Glad to have you with.
Thanks for having me.
The beard, I almost didn't recognize you.
It's hunting season. It's hunting season, so you got to get ready.
There you go.
That's why you grow one every year for hunting season.
It's
and
the beginning of September.
Really?
My wife marks it on the calendar, so she likes to not talk to me for a while.
Yeah. Gotta go through that those moments.
Yours is pretty good. Mine turns about 8 different colors on me. Mine go blue, orange, lots of gray, of course.
Well, you're starting to notice a little gray in there, so I guess that's a telltale sign.
Well, where are we going to start? Are we going to start by talking about the Vikings going to the Super Bowl, or we want to start with?
Why don't we? We brought up the discussion last week a little bit about Coach's Corner.
Okay.
I believe on the reffing in the WCHA and NCHC, and
okay.
I thought of two people when I thought of people to bring in to talk about things like that, and that was Bill Mason and Seven Simons. And I did get a hold of Seven today, and basically we brought you on, and we're just going to discuss how refs call games and if things are being called tighter than they normally are.
The discussion started on Saturday about UMD college hockey over the weekend. UMD played UMass Lowell. I think there were like 19 power plays in the hockey game. There was another college hockey game that had a similar number, and they were talking about that the number of interference penalties was 8 or better, and that only like 5 minutes of the first 2 periods was played at 5-on-5 hockey. And I guess the whole conversation came around Seven. Is that good for hockey? Is that good for college hockey?
Well, you know, it's it probably is in the long run, because this all kind of comes from the coaches, from my experience anyway, is that, you know, they want their skilled players to be able to play the game. And, you know, if you're going up against the team that you're just overmatching, if they're allowed to slow you down the whole time, I mean, you're not going to be able to play your game, and, you know, maybe the better team doesn't win because they're getting away with things they shouldn't.
Is it something, though, that, and I know this is, I hear 100% what you're saying, but college hockey, pro hockey, are fan-driven, money-driven. They need people in the seats to watch it to make, well, maybe not to make it go, but to make it viable. Do people want to watch 19 power plays in a hockey game? And I think the answer is no, but is it something that college hockey is saying, we want it to, this is something that we're going to stress early in the year, and we want to see it develop through the season?
Well, and I think that's exactly it, is it's going to start off that way early in the year, but the players are going to adjust. I mean, we saw that in the NHL a few years ago when they started cracking down. The players have just gotten better. They know what they can and can't do. It's going to be the same thing for college hockey, and ultimately we won't see a whole lot of 19 penalty games unless, you know, we have a little bit of a melee. But
will it be something that comes from both sides, though? The players will get better, but the referees are going to be, they're not going to be as stringent. Is that a natural tendency for a referee?
Yes and no. I think that a little bit, though, the referees have to kind of stick to what they're calling. Otherwise, you get into inconsistencies and trouble there, and then the players really don't know what you're going to call or what you're not going to call. So they have to stick to it a little bit, but I'm sure there will be a little bit of an ease-up period there further down the line as well.
What I'd like to know is, I wonder how many penalties were called the second night of that UMD-UMass Lowell game, because if I remember right, Sandlin, who's kind of tough on refs, he's pretty vocal, and there's nothing wrong with that. He's consistent, but he came right out and said he didn't want to talk at first, and then he opened up and said, well, that was an interesting game. And I'm sure refs, you being a ref, you obviously hear about things like that as far as a coach maybe not agreeing with some of the things you called and some of the things you did. How would you react to that?
Well, you know, if it was in a game discussion, you know, you always try and communicate with coaches. You and I had a lot of discussions over the years. So, you know, and that's, sometimes those discussions work and sometimes they don't. Obviously, going into the second night, if the ref had heard the conversation that Sandlin had with the media, maybe he goes in and says, hey, this is why we did what we did yesterday. And sometimes you can have that conversation, sometimes you can't. You know, there's always history sometimes between people, and that makes it tough, but they try and communicate as best they can, I think, and same thing with the coaches. You know, they try and communicate with the refs in a way that a lot of them, you know, they're all professionals. They try and tell them, hey, I don't like your calls, or, you know, I don't think you're doing this right, and here's why. And
now, Hockey East is where this game is played. A number of games were played out there. I believe there's a couple other Western teams out east playing in Boston College and Northeastern and things like that. So I'm just wondering if this one, because I went to the Bowling Green Bemidji State game. We'll get to that in a little bit. But I'm wondering if this was just a Hockey East, you know, basically step down and say we need to start calling this, or if this is a national thing. Have you heard anything on that?
You know, I haven't heard anything like that. I do know in my years working, I know that some districts called things a little tighter than others. You know, some you could, you headed over the world and you knew you were in for a tough game and not a lot was going to be called. You head down to some of the cities played games and, you know, there's 20, 30 penalties a game, every game, and it's just normal, and it's a lot of the interference and looking, and they just, they don't call that. So there could be a little bit of a difference. I think for the most part, college hockey tries to get on the same page, but Hockey East, maybe they're going a little stricter on the rules.
Okay, let's get a little more personal level here. As far as when you started ref, I know you played some high school hockey. You wore number 7. I remember things like that. Of course, why wouldn't you wear number 7? Your name was 7. But how did you get into reffing? I think I know why. And when did you start? And where did you start?
Well, I started when I was 13. I started pretty young, and I had an uncle that was a referee, and he was kind of higher up in the chain, and talked to me about it. And I said, well, yeah, that's something I might try. And, you know, we always need refs. And, you know, honestly, I saw it as a way to get a little more ice time. You know, skating, any extra skating is always good for hockey player. You learn the rules. It's beneficial all around. Turns out I had a little bit of a knack for it, so I just kind of stuck with it for a while.
Okay, that would be Teddy Olson?
Yep, Ted Olson, yep.
Okay, that's he grew up here in the Falls. Actually, pitched fast pitch softball with me on our Riley's team. I know he was a good ref. Do you know Daryl Gedney at all?
I know Daryl quite well.
What do you think of Daryl as a ref?
Daryl is timeless. Timeless is Daryl. I don't know anybody that can ref 900 games a year like Daryl can.
Yeah, he's definitely into it. I know he comes up every year and refs the Old Timers Tournament. And he fits right in with that. So now you're a retired referee. You don't do it anymore. Why did you get out? When did you get out?
Well, I got out, last year was my first season off, and I got out because, you know, I wanted to do some different things. I'd kind of accomplished just about everything I could as far as refereeing was going, and I found myself in my last year going to the rink and not maybe enjoying it as much as I should have, you know, and you can't be there for just a paycheck. That's definitely not what refereeing is about. If you're in it for a paycheck, you're there for the wrong reason, so... and I wanted to get into the coaching, and I kind of started to do that. I haven't taken on hockey yet, but I work with the girls' golf team, and so that's kind of the direction I wanted to go now.
Well, I give you kudos for not giving me the old answer that all us ex-coaches give. And the reason is because nobody wanted me to coach anymore, but they always... That always translates into, I need to spend more time with my family.
Ah.
Okay, so if you ever hear a coach saying that, more than likely they're getting run on, but not, no, I shouldn't say that, but not, that's kind of a reason. But you did not give that answer, that's awesome. So being out of reffing, you said you're not coaching in the hockey, was that something you'd like to kind of help out in town here?
Down the road, I'm looking into it. You know, younger kids especially, it'd be fun to work on the fundamentals with some of the kids. And, you know, just in what I've seen in golf, you know, for the 2 years that I've done it and to see people grow, it's just really rewarding. Mm-hmm. It's awesome to see them get that much better, and it's just a lot of fun.
Did you know rec hockey started today?
I did, yep. I've actually been looking at the schedule so I can get a little open hockey ice time in.
Well, you're going to go out there and lace them up and get your game ready for, what do they call it, Old Timers League.
Yeah, beer league's not far away.
So. Yeah, so that's always fun. And rec hockey did start today, so pretty exciting time for all the kids. And, of course, the lovely parents that show up at their rinks on a nightly basis. And looking forward to a good season. So who do we have any refs left in this town? I know we've had a plethora of them over the years. Have we got any left that do high school and things?
Well, with Bill being the athletic director now, he can't work the high school games, and Chad Chakowski is about, I think, the only one left.
Yeah, Chad's very good ref.
Yep, Chad does an awesome job, and, you know, so did Bill when he was working. You know, there might be some young kids out there. I haven't really gotten in touch with that stuff anymore, but hopefully there's some coming up because we're going
to
need them.
Because at one time you were kind of in charge of all the refs in town, which is always good to have one guy to kind of be the liaison between Mr. Mason, Bill Mason, and then the rec hockey, of course, was the one that gets you guys to do all the reffing. Do they have a lead guy? Would that be Chad, or do you know of anybody that's doing that now?
I don't. The last I heard, it was still kind of Bill doing the scheduling, and that you talked about. They took that over just for a little bit, for a few years there, just to kind of take a little bit off of Bill's plate. But yeah, I don't know that we have anybody out there that's kind of doing that now.
Okay, do you know Mint Harris at all?
Oh yeah.
Okay, I got a real quick story about Mint Harris, and you tell me you agree or not agree. I can see you're a little more open about this than you were when you were a ref, because I'd ask you questions then, and you always took the ref side. But we were playing Greenway. It was my only year in coaching high school, and it was 2010, I believe, right in there. And we're in Greenway, and we had the puck the whole game. Greenway's game was pretty much down. We had a good team, not a great team. We were way better, and we ended up having the puck the whole game. Well, we're in the middle of the third period. I'm about fit to be tied. We're up 2-0. Okay, they have 8 power plays and we have 0. I finally had to call Mint over with about 5 minutes left in the game because he just called another one. I said, Mint, I got a couple questions. One of them is how can we be called for 8 penalties in a game where we have the puck the whole time? Okay, he says, Bully, just stay there and coach, and I'll do the ref. And I said, well, maybe we should switch spots because this is getting really bad. And Minty, I don't know if Minty coached the next year. I'm sure it wasn't because of that. But Mint Harris, thoughts on him refing towards the end of his career? Anything?
Well, you know, there's a lot of knowledge there, obviously, yeah. You know, when you do it for that long. And it's good to have those guys around that, you know, they know the game. You know, once you're – you know, you can't keep up physically, yeah. Things like that. That's where it starts to get tougher, but great for knowledge for younger guys.
And
that sounds like a classic Mint line.
Yeah, I'm gonna get to the last question for you, and if you had to ref and you could ref one more game, okay, what level would it be at?
But you know,
and maybe who would it be?
You know, I always, one of my aspirations when I was younger, I wanted to do the WCHA back the way it was. So okay. Possibly, if it were still existing the way it was, North Dakota and Minnesota would okay. Be a great game. I love those high-intensity games. Those are the most fun. You're so involved. So that'd just be excellent. Obviously, doing a Stanley Cup would be cool.
Sure.
College hockey always just did it for me.
Awesome. And did you went to college, right?
I went here to Rainier River, yep.
Okay. So you don't have any allegiance to any WCHA team like Ringer does or anything like that?
Only the Gophers. I love the Gophers.
Oh, boy, you'd fit really good into this show.
How can you not like a team that takes Minnesota guys first? Come on.
They don't anymore. They take everything all over now. Their goalie, they had a big story on him about being in Alaska this weekend, and that's where he's from. But well, I'd like to thank Seven for coming on, and it's been an interesting conversation. You were a great asset. You answered the questions well. We had fun.
Thanks.
You want to stick around and talk about the Vikings?
Sure, I'll.
All right. Yeah, stick around. What the heck? So, the Vikes. What'd you think, Mike?
Well, I got that on page 4. I actually brought notes. I don't know.
Wow.
Vikings, only undefeated team in the NFL. We do know that. They're 5-0, and there's a little bar called Liquid Larry's. Yesterday on Sunday.
Working.
And Kenny working. Diana went with me, and she was kind of my assistant as we ran a little promotion with people watching the Vikings game and had a good time. And they were dominant. I mean, Houston didn't have a chance. I mean, the Vikings were so good on defense. They moved the ball on the offense. I couldn't find really many things wrong, maybe a couple penalties. Again, they're getting called a lot of penalties against them, but maybe that's because they're working hard and playing aggressive. But I was really impressed with the way the Vikings played. I really love Bradford as a quarterback. I think the team's the coach, there's not a better coach, is there?
I, right now, I don't know, besides maybe your good buddy Bill Belichick might still be right in there. But I'll tell you, Zimmer has this team working as a team, and I think that's the biggest thing. Everybody's on the same page. I think the biggest thing that I noticed in yesterday's game, you know, you always think about the secondary because, you know, it's all dependent upon pass rush and how long can they defend. And it just seems, I don't know what it is. It seems like they're right where they need to be. There's always a hand to be able to put there. There's not people that are wide open. And in past years, it seemed like that's the way it was. And I don't know if there's a technique that Zimmer teaches or what it is. But if it's confidence or what it is, but this secondary is playing at a totally different level, and it's basically the same guys. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what the difference is. I'm sure Zimmer can maybe put a better handle on it, but that's the thing that makes me wonder. That really has made this team gel, because now the defensive line's got that extra half second to a second to put pressure on the quarterback, and it really makes a difference.
Did you watch a game, Simon?
You know, I was riding home from the shack, and I listened to it, and the biggest thing I noticed is how they kept saying Houston hadn't got a first down without penalties through two quarters, and I thought that was pretty amazing. And yeah, I heard the stat about they've only given up an average of 200 passing yards, and from my recollection of Viking defense, that's pretty good.
That is outstanding, actually. I mean, that is a number that seemed to be that we are always in the bottom 10 of the league, and it really is something that makes the game far more enjoyable to watch, because you always think every time the ball goes in the air, you're like, we're going to have somebody there, rather than how open is that? You know, how open is that person? And with a week off coming up, with the bye week coming up and a chance to get ready for Philly, I don't know if that's a good thing. I think continuing to play when you're playing well, the bye could have come maybe later on in the season. Right now the team playing so well, you just wonder if that week off isn't going to take some of that timing away, some of that sharpness, some of that in there. I'm a little nervous about having the week off right now because they're playing so well.
Well, that's the easy thing to say. Okay, that'll come out quite a bit the next week and a half. Not only Ringer, my buddy here, but big shots like Paul Allen and all the big sports talk people down in the Twin Cities, even ESPN, Mike and Mike, I'm sure they're going to bring that up. Philly came off a bye week this week and went into, was that home? No, they were
at Detroit.
And got knocked off by the Lions, who were 1-3 coming in. So, you know, it's kind of coincidental that the Vikings coming in off the bye will be playing against the Philly team in Philly. So that's going to be interesting. I don't see an issue. I think it's much needed for the fact that that offensive line is totally beat up. They brought in Jake Long today, a former number or first-round draft pick, and another offensive tackle. They got to bring in some bodies and see if somebody can help them all, because they've had guards over on tackles playing guards, a center staying healthy, and Berger. But considering all the injuries they have, it's just like they put in the next guy. Thielen again had a big game yesterday. And did I not call that on Coach's Corner on Saturday? Well, I'll go back and watch it. That's exactly what I said.
You don't want to tell him you're
right. I said Thielen had a big game. You never will. Thielen had a big game. Cordero, I mentioned Cordero would probably have some good plays. And you know, they just basically bring in the next body.
Well, and somebody, if I was listening to the radio or if it was on, I think it was on the radio, and they were talking exactly about Thielen. So somebody out there must have known something was going on, because more than one person, not only you, were talking about Thielen having a big day. He apparently thought he was going to have a big day. So they apparently knew something about Houston's defense that they were going to be able to, either without Diggs, and that kind of scared me, without Diggs, that was going to be a little bit of a scary thing, but Thielen stepped up, and the whole team stepped up, and they continue to do it. It's fun to watch. Like I said, the defense is crazy.
I think they were watching our show, to be honest. There you go. I heard Bully mention it, and bang, it went nationwide. But Packers-Giants last night, Sunday Night Football. What I found to be kind of interesting is the Giants coming off a Monday night game. Okay, this hasn't happened for like 25 years. Yeah. Giants coming off a Monday night game, playing on the road against the Green Bay Packers, who are coming off a bye week. So the Green Bay Packers coming off a bye week, playing at home against the Giants, who played on the previous Monday night. So they got 6 days rest. Packers had 14 days rest. It's like, you know, the coaches weren't making excuses or saying, you know, the players were good about it. But a lot of the prognosticators, a lot of the sports talk people were kind of bringing up the fact that, you know, Green Bay, for some reason, is well-liked. And ironically, the last time this happened, Green Bay Packers were on the good end of it again. Okay, and I believe, I can't remember the team that did it 20 some years ago. But
are you trying to say that it's not coincidence?
Well, you know, that Vince Lombardi Trophy wasn't named after a guy from Minnesota. Okay, so
well, I think the interesting thing about the Giants, not only did they have to play on 6 days rest, but they had to play both those games on the road.
That's my point. Yeah. On the road,
and the whole back-to-back games on the road. Not that that's strange in the NFL, but on Monday night to a Sunday night against two pretty good teams, the Giant fans probably have something to gripe about.
Yeah, nothing would even have been brought up if the game was Green Bay at the Giants. It wouldn't have been even a brought-up session, but it was definitely brought up quite a bit. But getting back to Detroit, Philadelphia, Carson Wentz had his first turnover of the year, kind of a big one. Then Brian Matthews later fumbled.
Do you think he jumped the gun on trying to go deep with it? But there was probably what?
Was it first down?
It was first down. There was like 90 seconds left in the game. Think he got a little antsy?
Well, you know, you coach with Norty, and you guys over the period, unless you had Luke Zeke at quarterback, you guys would have never tried that. But, you know, the NFL, you got to do what's unexpected many times. And I'm guessing what happened is he had two plays called. He saw the guy one-on-one. He thought, you know, Wentz is a rookie. There might have been a double cover. They were hiding that double coverage, and he whipped it. He overthrew him by a long shot. So I don't think it was a bad call. I just think Carson overthrew him. That's going to happen. Kid's wound up. Boy, is he good, though. Talk about mature. Did you see his interview after?
Yeah.
My gosh, he handled that. He has little studious glasses on. He looked like a kid right out of college answering questions. And he is very smart. I understand he's a 4.0 student at NDSU. And quality kid. And I said this back. Geez, I'm doing a lot of I said this stuff today. But I said back in the original draft show when we had Logan on, I said, you got to take this kid Wentz because he's a good old boy, and he's no pretty boy like that Jared Goff, and he does things right. Yeah.
He's doing the job.
So the NFL, another great weekend. We got Carolina, Tampa Bay tonight. Who cares?
What about your boy Tom Brady coming in and throwing for 336 yards or whatever it was against the worst team in the NFL?
And we knew that was going to happen. He was going to be open up, wasn't he?
He's going to do it, I think, probably the rest of the season. Tom Brady plays with vengeance like no other player in the league. And if you wrong him in any way, he's going to make you feel bad.
He had a quote from yesterday. I feel better at 39 than I did at 29. So what's he trying to let everybody know?
Well, he said he wants to play until he's in his 40s. So.
Well, you'll never hear me say I feel better at 55 than at 45. That's never going to come out of this mouth. But good day in the NFL. My fantasy teams, I won in my main league. So I jumped to 4-1. I ran the coattails of Sammy Coates and Tyrell Williams and Carlos Hyde. So I'm 4-1 in that league. I'm 3-2 in the Viking league, and I'm my White Bear Lake team got another power.
Another power
four. But a good overall weekend in the NFL. Where are we going next?
The four play of the Gophers on Saturday. I love college football.
You too, Qatar. You're the Gopher fans.
I got to watch parts of that game, and the offense was anemic. I was getting tweets asking for Tracy Clay's head by the end of the game. They played, I don't want to say uninspired, but I've never seen, you know, Mitch Leitner's not the greatest quarterback in the world in the first place, and when he hits the receivers in the hands, I want to say, and I only watched half the game, I want to say I saw at least six balls that hit the receiver in the hand that were dropped. A lot of times I have a tough time saying that it was his fault that the offense was so pathetic, but that's the word. Pathetic is the word. I mean, Iowa is a decent team, but no big threat in the Big Ten, and it was just tough to watch. You didn't see any of it?
That I did not catch. But, you know, if the quarterback's throwing the ball, it's the receiver's job to catch it. So, like you said, he can't be that much his fault if they're dropping all these balls.
And it started right from the first play. First play of the game, they ran a little 7-8 yard out, hit the guy. I mean, he couldn't have thrown a better football, and the guy just plain just dropped it. There was nobody within 3 yards of him, and just plain dropped it, and it like started a whole rash of things. And so the Gophers 0-2 now in the Big Ten. And
so can we put the rest of this? Leitner is not going to be the first quarterback selected in the NFL draft. He honestly doesn't deserve to even get drafted. I know they're good. He's 6'5", 6'6", has a good arm. Maybe it's a system. I don't know. But He's really underachieved, and he's the reason, you know, I ain't doing it, but the quarterbacks get blamed, and they get the accolades when they win. So he's the reason that team's 0-2.
Your Bison win on Saturday?
Of course they did.
What was the final score?
31-3, I think.
That's pretty close. That's what I – something close
Bison.
To that. Go Bison, I believe.
They beat Iowa.
They did beat Iowa. That is correct.
Gophers couldn't beat Iowa.
No. Your Bison did it on the road, and the Gophers couldn't do it at home.
Yeah, and it's very disappointing. We had this, again, I'm going back in time, but I'm doing it a lot tonight. And we've had this discussion about 3-4 weeks ago. I said, I'm tired of the mediocrity and all the excuses, and I won't jump
and
on
I just
this
keep bringing
thing.
It up so that he can.
Yeah, because there's no reason to be excited about it. They're an average team in an average city in an average state. Okay? I love my state.
What does he say?
Wow.
Does not like Minnesota anyway.
No. Anyways, that's the end of Gopher football discussion. Gopher hockey went out to Alaska and put a pounding on a couple Nanooks and what's Anchorage there?
Oh, boy. That's a good one.
Seahawks.
Seawolves.
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 So the Gophers went out there. That's Donnie Ochia's starting point as far as his coaching career. Of course, he played at Notre Dame, and him and David Lorien was his assistant when Donnie was out in Alaska Fairbanks, and that's where he started his coaching. He said he kind of wanted to schedule this for the boys. It's always good for kids to go out to Alaska because it always seems Minnesota kids fall in love. Have you ever been out there?
Since? I have not been to Alaska. I've heard it's beautiful.
Yeah, it's a great place. We were there one time. Interesting place. We stayed right in Anchorage, and this is back in the early 80s, and interesting downtown. That's all I'll say.
Upset.
Illegal activity.
What else from anything else from college hockey over the weekend, Mike?
College hockey, not really North Dakota. I noticed they beat Canisius 6-0 the first night. Didn't see the second night. Did go to
4-1.
So they look like they're just reloading again. I saw some of their players. They got that Canas kid or Canoost or whatever. Colorado Avalanche first overall pick, I think 10th overall. And of course, the kid from Burnsville, nice player, number 16, a Bud Besser. They got three or four high-end defensemen, which they need because they lost Stescher. They lost number two. I can't mention the names. They do have two Pullmans playing. So North Dakota is loaded. I did go to courtesy of the mayor, Bob Anderson. See, he listened to our show on Coach's Corner, and he ran me down when I was coming out. He said, I would like to go to the Bowling Green Bemidji State game today. He must know me. Because I said, 1 second, I got to make one call. So I called Diana up, and she says, I'm all in. So me, Burke, and Diana went down. We had great seats. We were right down on ice level. Two rows, unfortunately, a crowd of about 1,000. Not a good crowd. And to be honest, early in the year, not a good product either.
Okay.
Both teams played very defensive. I don't know. Through 2.5 periods, it opened up a little bit in the third, but 2.5 periods, I don't know if there was 4 scoring chances. Okay, and it was hard for me to watch, and I saw Stevie Johnson there, him and Liz were at the game, and I wish I went over and talked to him now, because I just wanted to know if it was me or if it was, because Stevie's pretty knowledgeable on the game. I wanted to ask him what his thoughts were, because I had a hard time watching.
So, reffing-wise, we talked about the Hockey East. Was it more open? Was there stuff going on away from the play? Because that's what we talked about on Saturday, was a lot of that interference away from the puck, the little, just to slow people down, and you didn't see it in the...
No, and Seven knows me. I've never wanted to criticize a ref, and then basically when I was watching, I was checking it out, because we had that discussion earlier in the day on Coach's Corner about how the refs are maybe clamping down. I thought the refs did a really good job. I didn't see anything. I heard one goofy call that I've never heard, like intentionally trying to do something. But I know they're watching headshots both in the NHL and college. And, of course, high school started all that. And I just thought the refs did a good job. If I don't notice them, that means they are doing a good job.
Absolutely.
And I didn't notice them much. They called what they needed to call, and I agreed with everyone they did. And so I never found out anything there as far as whether they're calling them different in the, what's it called, WCHA than they are doing with the Hockey East.
This must be a different Mike Olmstead than I.
Than you remember?
Oh, I got a camera. I got a camera personality.
Yeah, there you go. So you're saying nobody can beat North Dakota in the NCHC? Is that what you're telling me?
Bulldogs. I like the Bulldogs team. They have a lot of veterans back. They lost Willie Korn, who's now playing for the Toronto Marlies. I think he's still there. It isn't the main club, but if he can stay with the Marlies, you're right in Toronto there, and you're one step closer to being in the NHL. He did enough last year. For my ex-coach, Lou Lamorello, who's a GM there now for Toronto, and he did it up there, and Neil Sheehy helped Willie get that contract signed, and Willie's doing a good job. He's working hard.
Okay. You want to talk Wild?
Yeah, we can talk a little bit, not a lot. Opening game is this Thursday. Did you know that, Seven?
I did know that. Okay. I got my countdown ready.
Awesome. And I think somebody told me that they played the St. Louis Blues. I'm not sure who that was that got me up to speed, but I appreciate that.
Yeah, Brother Gerald. But we got the Blues on the road. A couple new faces that you got to keep your eye on is this Christoph Bershey. He'll be playing on the fourth line with Zucker and another new guy by the last name's Joel Eriksson Ek. And I don't know if he's just going to have Ek on the back of his jersey or what it is.
Okay.
So he's a nice player, lots of savvy, kind of a European style, kind of like a Coy LeGrandin mix. Very smart, good at his own end.
You haven't liked those players, though.
Well, we'll see. I mean, I don't mind them if they add a little grit. You know, if you get the Mad Miko going, he's a great player. Now, if you get the Content Miko, who's kind of just going through the motions out there and playing his position and not getting intense and passionate, which these Wild players are going to have to do, by the way. This coach will not and has not put up with any of that lackadaisical effort. He's already sent a message to Tyler Grayback, who was sent down to Iowa. Just said, you know, at 6'5" and 225 pounds, and you just kind of don't hit anybody. You're not involved. You're not noticeable. He made the opening day roster last year. And got hurt right away, but Grayback should have been there. He should have made that team. Now they got to decide whether they're going to keep Ek over here for more than 9 games, because if they do keep him here for 9 games or more, then his contract starts. So then it's closer to free agency. Like they got a 3-year open window. So Ek, if he stays more than 9 games, I don't foresee that. I see they keep him through October and then let him go back to Sweden. But Ek, and then the third line, we have another new guy, Chris Stewart. He'll be playing with Halla and Nito Ryan. They split up Pominville. Pominville's up there with Koivu and Granlund. And then the first line has Parisi, Stahl, and Coyle, which. Those first couple lines, they got to put up some numbers. Pominville's got to get 25 to 30 this year. Parisi's got to put up double digits. I mean, we need more guys scoring. We need those 24-year-olds, the Coils, the Zuckers, the Neil Niederreiters, the all those. Time for them guys to step up. Joke's over. General manager, Fletcher, he's went way out of his way to nurture these kids and to get them groomed, and he's bragged about them for 3 years now. And Parisi and Suter came here because of the structure and the Wild players that were just, I mean, they had so many accolades. And that's why Suter and Parisi came here, because they saw a great future. Well, that window's closing. Both Parisi and Suter now are in their 30s. It's time for them to contend for a cup. However, when we get to my predictions, you'll see it's not good news.
Well, I hope you're wrong then, if that's the case. You got any feelings about the Wild?
Well, you know, I think they did a lot of good moves in the offseason, and one of them is a guy that we talked about, Chris Stewart. He played for the Wild for actually about half the season. They traded for him, and he's not your 20, 30 goal scorer, but he brings a little toughness to the mix, which is something the Wild have lacked tremendously in the last few years. They're not tough. They're not a tough team to play against. They're not going to pound you into the glass all game. And he's a little bit more of that player. He's going to drive to the net, and, you know, he's going to make it difficult for the opposing defense, and he's going to get in there and shake things up a little bit. You know, the other thing is Parisi was probably hurt, what, half of the year last year? And so it'll be interesting to see how he does being healthy. I think that's going to be helpful. And
the biggest thing, Seven, is what do you tell him to do? I mean, the reason he gets banged up is he plays in the low-down areas. Defensemen just, with the, you know, the old cross-check that refs let go, the air and
the referee's not doing the job.
Why, in the name of whatever, would the refs continually let the guys like Eric Johnson and all these thugs that play back on defense just continually cross-check forwards in front of the net. I don't get it.
He's got to get a little more Sidney Crosby and start complaining a little more, I think.
There's something to that. They all know Parisi's tough. He never complains. Very seldom complains at the refs. And then Crosby, well, if you listen to the Philadelphia coaches, who's the old coach, Tortorella, who's now where? Is he in Vancouver?
Yeah.
Yeah, he used to, he laid it right out there. He basically called Malkin and Crosby out for all their complaints. But I think you got a good point. I think someone has to. And Boudreaux has a reputation as a coach. I think that's going to help him. Where Yo was always the younger coach, and maybe the refs don't respect as much.
You know what? The other thing is, I'm a referee, and I'll tell you this. We're missing a guy like Boudreaux. We need that guy. You need somebody. You need a little bit of a protector out there. And,
we got one in game, bro.
He's going to have to do more, I think, because, you know, obviously I haven't heard about him a whole lot, so he's not pulling his weight as much as he needs to be. You know, if Parisi's getting beat up the way he has and everybody sees it, he's got to be out there the next shift busting somebody up for him.
Exactly. The way the NHL is now, too, is the fourth-line players need to go on play.
Yep.
And Boudreaux's a big fan. He says, we need to play four lines. And right now, I know Bruce Boudreaux's not happy with that fourth line. He knows he needs more grit, a line that can go out there, not necessarily score, but not get scored on, and be a good penalty killer. So you heard it here, too, is you will see maybe something happen within the first 2 weeks of the Wild. SCP Parento was waived today. I don't know what it would cost to bring in PA, but he's a 25-30 goal scorer. I'd love to see him get brought in, but we'll see what happens with that. Want my predictions?
I want your predictions. I'm dying to know, and I think everybody else is, because
really?
You know what's going to happen in about April. People. We're going to be going. You remember when I? You remember when in October when I said this? That's what I'm waiting for.
Okay, remember in October. Now it's October 10th as we take this, right?
Yep.
Okay, I'm just going to do the West. Frankly, I don't know what's going on in the East. There's so many teams, there's like 50 teams. And they're all like 10 miles away from each other.
Yep.
So they don't even take planes to games. Okay. They'll jump on a bus. But out in the West, we got, in the West,
okay. Pacific, the old Pacific. The old, what was the old division name of the West? It was the, there was the Smythe and the
Campbell.
What was the Wales?
Wales is in the East, I think.
The Wales Conference and the Campbell Conference. All that. See,
Chris Berman is called the NFL Norris. Yeah.
All right, so all West.
We got Anaheim. I got them getting first place in regular season. Doesn't necessarily mean they're going to do anything after. San Jose, who made that great run last year, found out they got some nice young players, which is what the Wild's going to need this year. I got them finishing second. My surprise team jumping into third is Calgary.
Okay.
Looks like the Tkachuk kid, number six overall pick by Calgary. Of course, Keith Tkachuk's kid. Is going to make the opening day roster, and it's going to stick. You got Monahan, you got Goudreau,
yep,
who just signed a new deal, six-year for $6.75 million for a guy who's 5'9.5 and 100.5. So we'll see what happens there. But I got Calgary. If they get goaltending out of Elliott, I see them as a third-place team. Over in the Central, is that what it's called?
Yep. Yeah, Central.
I got Nashville.
Okay.
You're going to see a big surprise. Yeah, you're going to see a big surprise in my picks here. Nashville with Chicago, I mean, you never go against the Blackhawks. Kane and Taves. Taves probably the best captain in the NHL. And the defenseman, Seabrook and Keith. The third is going to be St. Louis. And on, they got Yakupov in the big trade.
What about Dallas?
In fourth, Winnipeg.
Dallas is going to go to five.
Lane is going to be Rookie of the Year, third overall pick by the Winnipeg Jets, or second overall pick. Patrick Laine out of Finland, he will be your Calder Trophy winner, and he's going to be a big addition to that team. He'll probably be playing with Wheeler and whoever else, Scheifele maybe on that line. And Winnipeg's going to be tough. They got great defensemen. They're big, strong, mean. They're built perfectly for the West. They could do better than four. But right now, I got Dallas and Minneapolis.
Out of the playoffs.
Out of the playoffs. Dallas will make the playoffs.
So they're five? Or they're five, six?
Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
All four teams will come from the West. Four teams will come from the Central. The last 3 years, I believe five have come from the Central and only three from the West.
So you're going even.
It's going to be even this year.
So who's the fourth team out of the West? Then
LA Kings.
LA Kings.
LA Kings.
You got
quick.
Kopitar, who's pretty awesome. The loss of Lucic, going to Edmonton, could actually help the Kings. They're going to get faster, a little more skilled. And I think they had to play Lucic up in the, up in the top two lines because they paid big money for him. As soon as Gabbert gets back, I see that team making a big run at the end.
Okay, so who are you making a prediction? Who's coming out of the West in the playoff
for the Stanley Cup?
You want? Are you making a prediction out of the West? Yeah. None out of the East.
Not well, I can make one up. Okay. Okay, my team coming out of the West is going to be the Chicago Blackhawks.
Surprise.
Got to be. You got it. I mean, they're about every other year team. They were kind of remolded a little bit. They got rid of Bickle. They got rid of a few other hanger-oners, and they got Panarin's going to be there for a whole year. You got 2-3 lines. Holtz is healthy. They got 4 quality defensemen. They got one of the best goalies in Corey Crawford. So.
And they didn't make a run last year.
And the best coach in the NHL.
And they didn't make a run last year, so they got to make a run this year.
That's what they're going to do. They're well rested. They'll come out of there. So, that's my prediction. Blackhawks, and they're going to be playing the Capitals.
Okay.
Finally, the Capitals breakthrough.
Breakthrough? Yeah. Okay.
So, we'll see what happens. It's going to be a fun year. Wild fans, get used to this. It is going to be a tough year. I'm telling you. I watched enough of the World Cup of Hockey to see what everybody else has, and the Wild doesn't have to. Bruce Boudreau is going to keep that team, you know, visible for a while, but I just don't see it. I just don't see it.
Unless they make a move.
Yeah.
Unless they can't make a move, they probably can't.
When you get Pominville playing regular minutes, top two line, and Koivu, and Koivu should be a third line center. We got Stahl, who they're hoping is going to come back, and I don't see it happening. He's been dropping like this the last 3-4 years. Fletcher's throwing one out there to see if he can catch some, because he knows this is probably their last shot or two next year, too. Other than that, the cupboard's bare, man. They have nothing there. They're in a little bit of trouble, and you'll start seeing it this year. That's my prediction. My good buddy Bob Mason, if he ever gets his show, nothing against him. He's the best goalie coach in the NHL.
Why he keeps going through the other head coaches and he keeps keeping his job. Right? There's got to be a reason.
It's no coincidence. And I talked to Bob right when that was happening, and he wasn't answering his emails, but he did get back to me after the fact. I get worried that who's this bully guy? Emailed him. Bobby ain't gonna reply to it. But he always replies back to all the emails. But he wasn't much answering literally in the air.
You know, we haven't talked about the Major League Baseball playoffs. One iota the last couple of weeks. Do you want to make a prediction on the World Series?
Oh, I'll make a prediction.
You want to make a prediction? We don't have to talk about it, but now that the wild
card... about the paint that they just put in this place.
The wild card games are over, so now you kind of know. And, of course, we know one of the teams that's already in the ALCS. Toronto's already in, so... You want to make a prediction?
I want Kershaw to pitch every game.
Yeah?
Because the guy has personality. He's out there with a scruffy beard. He's a lefty. He kind of reminds me of the old, Ron Guidry's and the old school. He's got a delivery that isn't mechanical. You know what I'm talking about? Golf, and nowadays golfers, they all have the same swing. Kershaw has that different pitching motion, which just brings me back to the Venezuela, and Mike Cuellar, and all these guys with personality. Now that, to me, I think what's wrong with both baseball and golf is it's gotten so mechanical that it's really hard to distinguish players from one another. I mean, I used to watch the Twins. I knew who was on the mound. I knew who was up. You know, that little Cesar Tovar up there. They always had these little idiosyncrasies. You know, the Chichi Rodriguez and Trevinos and Fred Couples. When you saw them swing, you didn't have to know. They didn't have to give a name. You knew who it was.
Sure.
Nowadays, I mean, you sit up there and watch the Ryder Cup, I swear 11 of the 12 guys in the U.S., and Jim Furyk not included because this is unique, but 11 of the 12, they have the same doggone golf swing. And what do you think on that? You're a golf coach.
Well, I think now they're trying to streamline it because they've perfected it, they think. But the thing is you still have to do what works for you. I believe it was Arnold Palmer, rest in peace, who had a quote on that too, about, your golf swing has to be yours, and not everybody's is going to look the same, and you got to do whatever works for you. You look at Bubba Watson, he's another one, fellow lefty along with me, and his swing is a little bit different. It's not quite as refined, but those guys get it done. Furyk's another one. You said that it is completely unorthodox compared to everybody else, but they make it work, and that's fine. It doesn't good, bad, right, wrong, and different. You know, as long as they get results.
Yeah, and the idea too is if everything's swinging is, can be consistent, then the results should be the same. But I remember Stickman. I think I brought this up one other time on the show. He said, "Bully, you kind of do everything wrong the whole way. But when you get to impact, you're right on the money, and that's what matters." Yeah. I thought Stickman. That was a great analogy. If you see a lot of the good golfers out of Falls Country Club, there might not be a lot of pretty swings, but they're in the right spot at the impact. So that's kind of the idea.
You're trying to get out of making a prediction. World Series.
Baseball?
Who makes the World Series?
I don't even know who's in it. Cleveland's looking good. It looks like they're going to knock the Red Sox out. Toronto hits the ball all over the place. I like that, but you still need pitching. So I'm going to go Cleveland and my buddy Kershaw. I'm having the Cubbies. They're going to beat the Giants, so they'll get on to the finals. But I got the Cubbies can't beat the Dodgers.
Can't.
It never happens. Read the books.
There you go.
You know, 1912 was the last time the Cubbies.
I'm saying it happens.
You saying it happens? I'm saying a little side wager here.
So Cubbies and
Cubbies.
Cleveland, Toronto, or Boston right now?
You know, I'm a big Yankees fan, so I don't like to say Boston. They've got a decent team, and that's why I think that the Cubbies are going to be there. Theo Epstein, he's kind of a genius back there, so I think he's probably got them there this year.
A week ago, I know I said that San Francisco wins. They won in 10 and 12 and 14, so 16 meant they were going to make it. They don't look very good right now, down 2-0 against the Cubs, who won 100-plus games. So I don't see San Francisco being able to come back and beat the Cubs three times in a row. Even though the next two games are at home, I find that tough to do. So as much as it pains me, I will pick the Cubs out of the National League. I'm going to take Toronto. They're playing good ball right now. And I'll go back to my point at the start of the show. They're going to have to wait for this Cleveland and Boston series to get over. And then they are going to have to wait for the NL series and all that. They're going to have to wait. And right now they're hitting the ball real well, and that is going to be something that you need to keep playing when those kinds of things are happening. It's going to hurt them. I still pick Toronto and the Cubbies, and as much as it pains me, I think the Cubbies will take care of it. I don't like to see these kinds of things die. I like you know, history and the fact that when Boston won back in 04, they took the Bambino curse and got rid of it. I didn't like it. It's
so upset.
I've been around since only 1969, and so yeah, keep the curse going. But right now, I don't think the Cubs were on the brink in game one. It was 0-0 in the eighth, and they had a home run in the bottom of the eighth. If they lose that game, I think the psychology could have gone the opposite way. San Francisco wins a game in Chicago, and all of a sudden you're talking going back to San Francisco for two. That one hurt the Giants. I just don't think they can beat them 3-0.
Should be fun.
Anything else? You got any other pieces of paper?
I got one other thing, and let's get on a serious side here. The Mr. Beat Foundation, they're having a banquet this weekend, and this will be the third annual. I'm heavily involved, but on the outside. Okay, we got a group of hockey players that played for Michael, from peewees all the way up to high school, and the group goes from about 1977 to about 95, the same tournament team in 95, 96. I think Michael's coach passed that group, but our group, the late 70s when we graduated, and then also we've mixed with the Johnny Austin's group of the 95s and things like that. And what we did is we email each other starting about July, and we organize stuff that we can do to help out the Mr. Pete Foundation. Mr. Pete, Michael Peterson is now an Ord at the center there. I'm guessing because it's a good facility, and Renee obviously is probably real careful. I mean, this is tough for me. I got to be real careful because. I know he's in Ore right now, and I'm not sure if he's going to be at the bank, but I hope God he is. But Louis, he's got Louis' body dementia, and I don't know enough about it to really get into detail, but Louis' body dementia, also known as dementia with Louis' bodies, is the second most common type of progressive dementia after Alzheimer's. Okay, so it's another one of those type diseases, also called LBD. Estimated 1.4 million individuals nationwide. Okay, this is happening. I got a friend whose wife has it. She's a homemaker. Another friend of mine, she ran our human resources department. So this disease, like most diseases, doesn't pick by what you do, what you did. Michael, of course, was a teacher and hockey coach and an amazing teacher and coach, and they kind of went hand in hand. And what we've done then is, you know, we try to help the family out because all the money stays local, and it's basically, it isn't to cure the disease. It's basically, since Michael, teaching was so important in his life, that they decided the best way to honor him with this cruel disease was to have this banquet and then also raise money to give scholarships to help teachers with grants. And basically anybody can apply. I don't know if you've ever had to. I think maybe it's a lot of it's for the elementary teachers, but I know a lot of the teachers are getting grants every year to help build classrooms and help with projects that they want to do. And they're very generous with the support. We're raising anywhere from, I guess, $25,000 to $35,000 in the first 2 years of this event. So what we do, and I'll show a couple of items that are going to be, if you don't mind, get that stuff. These are just a couple of the items I got so far. Drew Fisher got this jersey when he played overseas in England last year. And Drew was one of my players, and I called Drew up, and he says, not a problem. And usually jerseys come free. I know for a fact Drew Fisher made up his own money on this, okay, which is awesome. He's got a signature there. If you look at it, over in Europe, they aren't afraid to advertise. You got a McDonald's ad and the Grand Casino. So casinos are nationwide. So this is from over to England. Danny Blaze, of course, very generous in his donations. He offered this Nebraska Omaha jersey. We did get there it is, number 21. I asked for a Randolph jersey. If you look at this real close, this looks like a last year jersey because it's a little dirty and a little stained. And I asked for a Randolph jersey. I think Randolph did wear number 21, of course, to do the scrap. Then we got the hockey stick. I don't know where I put that. Well, anyway, it's a hockey stick that Big Buff, Dustin Bufflin, got over to Kelly Myers for us. Kelly, of course, the Myers family is very close to the Bufflins, and Buff's been coming up in our summer hockey for years. Still owes my son, Burke, his helmet back, because Burke let him use his helmet one night.
There's the stick.
Here's the stick right here. As you can see, it's a little big. Usually, I have my sticks ball right here, so Buff's a big boy, and this is actually a signed hockey stick. It also has this tape job that he actually uses, so that it's authentic. It's how he tapes up his stick, so some young lad would be looking pretty good with this thing. But we also got a Devin Dubnyk signed jersey. We got a Tim Sheehy, 1966 grad. He also graduated with Michael Peterson. We got a Tim Sheehy Boston College jersey.
Nice.
It's been my most awesome possession I got. And Tim helped me out with it. And I was talking to the SIDs and the DISs and the PRBs. They had a lot of stipulations. They had to make sure that the money wasn't going to go to certain kids and that would be a recruiting violation. So it was a really tough thing getting these jerseys. But I know Neil was having Tim sign that, so we're going to have that there. And Neil always comes through. He's going to get four tickets to four different Wild games. Wild games. Kevin Erickson donated a fishing guiding trip to our group. There's a bunch of other stuff. And we try to help out as much as we can. It's getting tough getting these jerseys every year, but I'm not afraid of the word no, so I'm going to keep pushing it. And you're going to get two answers when you ask for something. It's either going to be yes or no. Right now, Michael Peterson can't answer that question real well, so I'm going to go out there and keep doing this and do the best I can every year. And each one of these players, I think we've raised like $1,500 right now. Each one of us put $100 in, and then we put a little note to the family, too. So it's a pretty special deal with Bruce Ratlin, Todd Padlock, Neil Sheehy, David Lorien, and Bob Mason. I mean, all future guys, hopefully soon, the Bob Masons, the David Lorien's, Bruce Ratlin's, are going to be Hall of Famers for the Falls High School. So, great group. I call them too. Michael was part of a group that handed out a lot of scholarships. Just in our group alone in '78, we had 11 kids in Division I. So, we owe him. Yeah, we got to pay back, and this is a way of getting involved. We try to stay on the outside, but for something like this, we just want people to show up at the banquet, donate their money, and help out. This goes to all our local schools, and it helps our teachers. So that's what it's about. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned the Hall of Fame. We are voting next Monday. So next Monday we get our show done.
I got to skedaddle because we got to get in.
All right, if Bob Mason, Gary Sampson, Bruce Ramble, and David Warren are on the list, they should all get in.
There you go. You hear it here first. We'll see what happens. We'll make an announcement shortly thereafter. I know it'll come out in the paper probably NEA Saturday thereabouts. We'll make it public on who was nominated once we've figured out who's going to be inducted. We'll get a hold of them, and once everybody's been informed, then we'll get it out into the hospital.
It's great for the community. It gets a lot of people together. A good fundraiser. Lots of people coming back to town. Fills up beds, and good job on that, Ringer, as always. And to our guests, what do you think of him?
He did awesome. We'll have him back again. We'll have him back mid-season or something, and we'll talk about hockey again.
It sounds like he's at the Shack a lot, so we could have talked some bird hunting with him, but we were, you know.
Well, if we get him in the middle of the winter, there won't be any Shack. He'll be out ice fishing or something, because we know that he...
And I got a hold of Seven today, and I asked him if he'd seen our show before, and he said no. I said, well, that's going to happen.
Very good. Anything else, Michael?
Nothing. Don't take us too serious.
All right. Thanks.